living. It's okay, it's been like that since I was a baby. Thoughts deep, scuba. My mind's free, opposite of Cuba. Take me for my money and my fame. Papa, don't try and see right through ya. Four lawsuits, 1 year. Two down, two to go. Fame, expensive, yeah. Good thing, I know. I was built for the war. I was built to be all yours. Abuelita's a rebel, my mother's a fighter. Diaz and G and my sister's a rat.
Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. The keynote luncheon is about to begin. Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. The keynote luncheon is about to begin. Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. The keynote luncheon is about to begin. Ladies and gentlemen, please mute your cell phones. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Rob McRae, President and CEO of the Wireless Life Sciences Alliance.
Good afternoon. For those of you who are here in the morning for our super session, I apologize that I'm back on the stage. Maybe it's punishment for running over time, but I think it's because I can stitch together why consumer electronics, health communications, and health care go together to do keynote addresses for your luncheon. But first, you know, there's always a lot of invisible people involved in these conferences, and there are about 1,800 plated lunches out there. 50 minutes ago, there were none. There was sort of the detritus of coffee and glasses from the morning sessions that ran over. And so I just wanted to acknowledge the amazing Gaylord banquet team for turning over this room. So we have three really good addresses this afternoon. And first, it's my pleasure to introduce Gary Shapiro, who is the president and the CEO of the Consumer Electronics Association. CES, the Consumer Electronics Show, of course, is perhaps the better-known brand. And it represents about 2,000 companies from around the world. It's really interesting to have CEA here. For those of you who are at the show in January last year, their show, you might have remarked that Life Technologies introduced the world's fastest DNA sequencer intended for desktops at the Consumer Electronics Show. Now, I tell you that 5 years ago, even I would not have predicted that. But the world is changing, and we are moving to getting the advantages of the consumer electronics industry, where everything gets cheaper and better over time, and bringing that into healthcare, that's our fond wish. Gary is an author. He's had a very successful New York Times bestseller called The Comeback, How Innovation is Restoring the American Dream. That was a 2011 book, and he has another one coming out in January, Ninja Innovation, the 10 Killer Strategies of Our World's Most Successful Businesses. So he studies this area. He's represented it for decades. He believes that innovation supported by appropriate government policies can lead the U.S. to leadership and lead to a world of better products and change where it is necessary. He writes regularly for Forbes, for the Daily Caller, for the Huffington Post, for CEO Magazine, for Fox News. He's obviously bipartisan, as you can tell from all of those. And please give a warm welcome to Gary Shapiro.
Appreciate it. Thank you, Rob, and thank you to HIMSS. And thanks to Rich Scarfo, who really created this event just a few years ago, and it's grown into something absolutely fabulous. You know, what people don't know is that Rich Scarfo, who's standing off stage, actually I met 30 years ago. And he worked at the Consumer Electronics Association for the CES. I'm in the same job, and Rich has gone on to do fabulous things and create this great event. I want to, when Rich called and asked if I would do this, I really jumped at the opportunity. Because I think what is being done in this environment, in the intersection between technology and healthcare and delivery and trying to reach consumers, is absolutely critical. If you look at the headlines now and you turn on your television set, all we hear about is this physical cliff. Two things about that cliff. First of all, it has to do with, everyone talks about taxes. I'm not going to talk about that. It talks about expenses and taxes. Expenses, the biggest expense for government, the fastest growing expense is obviously healthcare. To the extent that innovation and technology can lower those costs, That is a really good thing. The other aspect we don't talk about when we talk about deficits in any developed country is there are three things at play. It's not only taxes and revenue and expenses, it's also about economic growth. Economic growth comes only from innovation. Innovation is difficult. Innovation is something which is always challenging the existing way of doing something. So if you're an innovator, you're challenging the status quo. Now, healthcare policy ties into this totally. Not only is it a great expense, it's a great opportunity. And the demographics, the aging population, the explosion in obesity and type 2 diabetes is very big. And obviously, we have the solutions here. We have the solutions with the software, the applications, with nanotechnology, with robotics, with remote care delivery, with biometrics and genetic mapping, with electronics and biometrics on a chip together, and so many different ways and new things that are happening very, very quickly. And the question that we have to ask ourselves is, do our institutions, can they keep up with this? The solutions that we're talking about require what I would call ninja innovation. Ninja innovation is, to me, is not only for companies and people, but it's also for governments and nonprofits and NGOs in terms of how you approach problems. And honestly, our organization, which produces the largest innovation event in the world, the International CES, as you just heard from Rob, ninja innovation is something I talk about with my children as well as with our employees. And ninja innovation, to me, is if you face a problem of any type, you try to solve that problem in a creative way with the tools at your disposal. What's in your environment to do that? And you have to think outside the box. I know many of you are in management, if not most of you, and think about how your employees address something. If you're faced with a problem and you give it to them, do they come back to you and say they couldn't solve the problem, or do they come back with a solution? Whose monkey do they put that back in? Do they put it back on your back, or do they solve it? And that's how you evaluate employees, that's how you get ahead in your career, and that's what you do, and that's what we have to do as a society. You have to break down that roadblock. And we have a few roadblocks we have to break down, frankly, in our society, having to do with what we're trying to accomplish with healthcare and delivery systems to consumers. We have a legal system which we have to confront. In the United States, we have about 1 million lawyers. And the lawyer's job is sometimes to expedite things along through the process, but more often than not, we're producing literally tens of thousands of people out of law school who are relatively unemployed, and any one of them can file a lawsuit and slow you down and sue you for something that they shouldn't. My view of the world is we have to go to a loser-pays litigation system. We have to get rid of the patent trolls, which are affecting not only startups and big companies, but everyone with an idea is getting hurt by the fact that anyone can sue without any great recourse. And we have a healthcare system where doctors are incentivized not to try something new. It's better to do something safe and to old than to try a riskier treatment, a new way of delivering healthcare service. So we have to have a legal mindset that changes. And that goes to our regulatory system as well. The FDA in the United States has been fairly creative in trying to cut down some of the permission times and the approval times. And we've gone from a system where it takes up to 20 years to a system in some cases a few months or a few years. But in the technology world, we're in a totally different time scale. We're talking about months to respond to competition, to come out with something new or better. So we have a collision of cultures between a government regulatory world and a government approval world. And what we have to recognize, I think, as a society is levels of risk acceptance. Now, when you're talking about flying in an airplane, as many of you did to get here, you don't really want to have that much risk. You want to make sure that regulation is very, very rigorous. But when you're talking about something which can save time and money or cure a disease in a risky way or try something new, we have to evaluate the risk against the potential reward. Now, my wife is a surgeon. My in-laws are doctors. I go to a lot of medical conferences, and I hear a lot about medicine. And what I hear about is, at least it's structured in the United States today, it's not that favorable. in terms of the regulatory system. The treatment evaluations do not consider, for example, the cost of various treatments. They don't consider the patient inconvenience. They don't consider how uncomfortable it is to get an injection or a drug. They don't consider the caretaker in having to get someone to get treated. They don't consider the cost of transportation, of gas, and the effect of the environment. They don't consider the benefits of remote treatment. They don't consider how the healthcare provider can be incentivized to deal remotely with a patient. Our healthcare system is based in a system that was before the internet, and we have to shift over. And honestly, I don't think it's getting better. Just on January 1, there's some new rules going in effect for reimbursements for healthcare providers, at least in my wife's area, where the doctors are reimbursed less if they do two procedures in the same office visit. So how are doctors going to respond? They're just going to spread out and have patients come for more office visits. It really doesn't make much sense in terms of how at least the United States reimbursement set up for doctors in terms of dealing with patients and technology. In some cases, innovation is not only not encouraged, it's discouraged. The new healthcare law, which is now the law in the United States, has a lot of good things about it. But what is in there? There's a tax on innovation. There's a tax as of January 1 on new equipment and newer devices that have to do with healthcare delivery. Now, the larger companies, they could afford to pay it. It's not a great idea. But if you're a startup and you're being taxed not on your profit, you're being taxed on your revenue, that is not a healthy thing. Doctors in the United States, for example, are incentivized to inject on the basis of the cost of a drug. They are reimbursed. They get a percentage of the drug. So there's two drugs which are the same for a form of macular degeneration. The National Eye Institute did a great thing. They compared the effectiveness of two drugs, Avastin and Lucentis. Avastin is about $35 an injection. Lucentis is $2,500 an injection. Doctors get reimbursed a percentage of the injections. What do you think doctors prescribe? The only reason a lot of doctors aren't prescribing the cheaper drug is because some of the patients can't even afford the 20% copay under Medicare for that drug. So we have an incentive system which is costing our government about $1 billion a year of doctors prescribing the most expensive drug. And even the most ethical doctors, and I've met them, said, I've had to go over. I'm losing $100,000 to $200,000 a year. Plus, we have an incentive system which allows Genentech, the drug producer in this case, to actually give secret rebates to doctors that use enough of the expensive Lucentis drug. And this was reported in the New York Times, and it was a subject of a hearing before the Select Committee on Aging. And the senators bipartisan stood there and said, I can't believe you do this, and it's legal. And you know what? That was a year ago, and it's still perfectly legal for doctors. And that's money being wasted out of the healthcare system. So a better healthcare system would encourage innovation, would focus on cost, would focus on motivations, and would get together the different players and stakeholders, and rather than have political solutions, have solutions that the different stakeholders could come up with and come together. We also have to change our culture a little bit. I'm going to ask you, how many of you have heard of Kim Kardashian? Raise your hand if you've heard of Kim Kardashian. I see a lot of hands going up. Well, that's great. What does she have to do with healthcare and technology and mHealth? Absolutely nothing. How many of you have heard of Joseph Murray? I do not see one hand in the room. There is the tragedy. Joseph Murray died a few weeks ago. He was 93 years old. In 1954, there were two identical twins, and one of them was about to die of end-stage kidney disease. He had an idea that he could take a healthy kidney from one twin and put it in the other. And he did it successfully. Indeed, Richard Herrick, who received that kidney, went on to live 8 more years. He married his nurse. He had 2 kids. And that established the principle of organ transplant, which forever changed many lives across the world. In 1962, Dr. Murray did the first organ transplant of non-twins, an unrelated person, and it succeeded. And now kidney transplants and other organ transplants are fairly common. In 1990, Dr. Murray won the Nobel Prize. And certainly the fact that in America today, no one knows his name, and his obituary was relegated to the very back pages with a short paragraph, is we are honoring the Kim Kardashians of the world, and we're not honoring the Joseph Murrays. And when you think about the future of our society, and how we're going with healthcare regulation, and who we make cultural heroes, are the best and the brightest going to be going into medicine in the future? And that's a question we have to ask ourselves, because it's tougher and tougher to be a doctor, and they are no longer the science and technologists are no longer the cultural heroes. I have to say the exception to that, in a sense, to the extent he was a scientist, is Steve Jobs. When he died, he was a cultural icon, and because he changed so many lives directly by what people were wearing and what they held, he was edified as a person to emulate. But there's very few of those out there now, and I think as a society we have to address that. We have to address that the way Congress did in the House of Representatives last Friday. The House of Representatives, almost all the Republicans and 35 Democrats, voted that for the United States, we're going to change our visa policy. So that instead of having random immigration and lottery winners from anyone in the world who wants to come here and happens to be the lucky one who gets selected, we would actually take the PhDs from the U.S. universities in science, technology, engineering, and math, and let them stay in the United States. Sadly, the Obama administration now opposes this, and that legislation will die in the Senate. So basically, our White House, our government is on record now as saying we would rather have random immigrants than PhDs from Harvard. I spoke a couple of months ago about this before in Boston, and there was a lot of Harvard people in the audience. So many Harvard PhDs came up to me, literally with tears in their eyes, saying they want to stay in the United States, or they're running institutes at Harvard. They want to do, and they cannot get the best and the brightest anymore because of our immigration policies. I think we have to change our mindset and celebrate innovation and celebrate what we do. It should be our national strategy. The United States, we have this phenomenal diverse culture. Diversity is our strength. We have a questioning society. Our school kids benefit from the fact that we're always being asked questions. We know how to innovate here. We have the best motion picture industry, biomedical industry, technology industry. We have so many things we're really, really good at, but so many things we have to change. Now, what we do as the Consumer Electronics Association, as you heard, we are a nonprofit. We have 2,000 technology companies as members, and we've really expanded into the area of healthcare. We own and produce the largest innovation event in the world, the International CES. It'll be held January 8th through 11th in Las Vegas. You're all invited. Please register. It'll attract about 150,000 people from around the world interested in innovation. It is not open to consumers. You must show that you have a business or academic reason to go. There'll be 3,000 exhibitors there. About 10% of them will be focused on healthcare and innovation. We have a whole healthcare portion of our show, which is up 25% over last year. We have healthcare tracks. We also have a demographic track aimed at the aging population, our Silver Summit. We have a whole portion of the show focused on fitness and healthcare technology, digital health. And it's not only about applications and biometrics and healthcare monitoring, it's how we gather this as a system. And some of the leaders in healthcare will be speaking, including Dr. Sanjay Gupta, as well as the CEO of Qualcomm, Paul Jacobs, and the CEO of Verizon, Lowell McAdams. And having met with Lowell last week, I'll tell you, they're going to be talking about healthcare big time, very important. So we invite you to that. We invite you to the Consumer Electronics Association. We're a membership, corporate membership organization. Anyone is welcome to join with a business interest. Our dues are fairly low. We actually have a booth as part of the exhibit hall. And we do a lot of research. One of the things that we're having a research session tomorrow morning at 7:30, where we unveil our research on what consumers want in healthcare and what they plan to buy. And let me tell you something, about one-third of Americans will buy a digital health product in the next year. And we'll be talking about the demographics, what they want, and how we're doing it. But I think what we have to do is we have to take the great knowledge that's inherent in the consumer electronics industry, which is mass market distribution at low cost, plugging into systems and retailers, and we have to marry ourselves with, frankly, the concerns of healthcare providers, of privacy, of security, and also integrate somehow, bring back the healthcare regulatory and legal structure, which is focused on some difficult regulatory hurdles because we have an obligation and an opportunity as a society to solve some of these difficult problems for healthcare for people and also the financial problems that our nation and other nations face. What I wanted to do to make this more interesting for all of us, though, is turn this over to you to ask any questions. There's microphones there. But if there's one message I wanted to leave you with, is that as we approach healthcare holistically, we cannot let the perfect become the enemy of the really spectacular, great, and the good. And that's what some ways we're going with healthcare, with our legal, regulatory, and political system. And we have an obligation, all of us, to try to change the system. So that's why I am speaking about these issues. And I'll give you another honest answer why I've written two books, why I write a weekly column. I've written 120 op-eds in the last year. Is that I'll make it personal for you. I am well past the age of membership eligibility for the AARP. And I married for the second time, and my wife and I didn't think we'd have any children. And I'm not allowed to give my wife's age, but she's younger than me, but not by double digits. About 4.5 years ago, 5 years ago, we found out she was pregnant, and what a miracle that was. We had a baby, and that got me thinking in a spectacular way that, my God, I'm not going to be around for a lot of this kid's life. You know, when you're a younger parent, you don't think about it. It's just the flow of life. When you're an older parent, you actually think about the future much more in different ways. So you realize you have an obligation to the next generation, especially if you're not going to be around for them. So I think what we do as a society and as individuals is very important. The other part of the story is, you would think I'm a very highly educated person. I know how babies are made. But we have another one now. I have a 7-month-old. And I know. Yes, finally, the audience is there. If there's anyone in a microphone, please, I really can't see you, but if you could introduce yourself and ask your question.
Hello. My name is Dr. Nadine Levick, and I'm downstairs as one of the not-for-profit sort of public health approaches to utilizing technology, social media, and as a resolution to a problems in public health. One of the challenges we've faced is how, as a social good, social media project, do we get funded when there's not a lot of commercial benefit other than the prime benefit of saving lives? Our project is called iRescue, and it's involved in using tools that exist currently, such as social media, to identify locations of cardiac defibrillators so that when an emergency happens, we know how to access the tools that are there. We have those pieces of the puzzle, but we don't have the systems engineering to put them all together. But that's what we're working on. But funding for a social good project, where the benefit is saving lives, not dollars, has its challenges.
I'm sorry, and where are you located?
Well, it's a global project. I'm Australian, but I'm based in New York City.
Okay. So thank you. Honestly, I didn't catch the total question because of the sound, but what I understand you're asking is you have a project focused, and social media is an important aspect, but there's not a way of paying for that.
Correct. Well, a social good project. Correct.
Okay. Obviously, social media has fundamentally changed everything we do, and it's part of what we have to deal with. What I'm encouraged by is the fact that applications are coming very quickly, which are allowing people to link up in ways they never have before. And I think that that is a phenomenal opportunity, whether it's people voluntarily giving their information and for genetic mapping encouraged by social media, or the Human Genome Project, or even part of the new healthcare law, which gathers information on a privacy-deleted basis. But in terms of social media, what social media has allowed is people with common ailments to get together and solve problems. And I know in walking around the exhibit floor, I saw the social media being part of some solutions. So if you can make sure this is a question and keep it brief, I'll answer as many as possible. Yes, please identify yourself.
Hi, Gary. Neil Agate with Kinergy Health. I will make it a question. I was thrilled to hear that you were speaking as from the consumer side, because I think that's what we need in healthcare, is more of a focus on consumer side. So I'm curious on what you've seen either here or in your other aspects of your work that combines the consumer, the great innovation with the consumer electronics with healthcare.
Thank you. You know, the truth is, for consumers to do anything and deal with, they have to use a device of some part, of some point. And you know, the fastest growing product right now is tablets, obviously. And the second fastest is smartphones. And the penetration, not in the United States, but elsewhere in the world, is absolutely huge. It's just unprecedented in terms of penetration. And obviously, both those products being wireless and relatively inexpensive and coming down in price allows great penetration virtually everywhere. But you do need, obviously, a broadband connection. And that is increasingly an issue in terms of spectrum availability and handling the systems. In terms of consumers doing it, this is where I think we have to focus on the great being the enemy of the good. There is no wireless connection which is perfect. It does break down. We all know that. We've lost phone calls. And that is a, if you're relying on your systems being monitored wirelessly, you have systems break down. You also have, someone has to monitor that. Now, it could be done with a computer, but ultimately there'll be a doctor involved. Doctors aren't going to be sitting and monitoring things, and there's no compensation system which encourages that. There are some creative solutions I heard on the floor whereby basically patients are, you know, maybe fully reimbursed and not even have a deductible if they are automatically monitored, if they're having their blood pressure taken, things like that. I think that's pretty exciting. Next question.
Thanks. I'm from DevEx Impact. We're a website devoted to the intersection of business and international development. A question about your members. As they move into emerging markets, do you see them increasingly interested in global health issues, reaching the bottom of the pyramid in a business-driven way? Thanks.
So the way I understand your question is it, are technology companies going to be offering their wares to the public at large, even around the world, even those that don't have much money? And I think absolutely yes. Because that is the cycle of innovation and technology. If you go back to even the most basic thing like plumbing or electricity or other things that people have taken advantage of, it starts out very expensive and the cost curve comes down dramatically and it goes on. I remember traveling around Vietnam a few years ago and seeing even in the least developed areas, people were, they didn't really have electricity, but what they did have is car batteries, and they were using those to charge their cell phones and get television reception. The fact is that technology comes down phenomenally in price over time and relatively quickly. Some companies like Nokia, for example, have made that a business strategy to go after the world. Other companies like Apple are a little more high-end, and they go after people who can afford more. There's, you know, companies define their niche and their own strategy. But innovation and good ideas spread quickly, and obviously through social media, good ideas really spread quickly. What we benefit from, though, is phenomenally intense competition. Being a company in the consumer electronics space is absolutely brutal. Being a consumer is a wonderful thing. And, you know, as I travel around the world and deal with my colleagues around the world, I am thrilled to see how technology has pervaded. And obviously, I know everyone here knows this, the wireless space has made it even easier. You need, you know, it's much more cost effective, you need less infrastructure, and applications and services are developing quickly which allow things to be delivered in the most cost effective basis possible. There's a company which will be exhibiting at, featuring at the International CES in Las Vegas in January called HealthSpot. HealthSpot is a company which has created this little room. It's a private room, and you can put it anywhere in the world with internet service. And you walk in that room as a patient with a problem. You sit down, it weighs you, it takes your blood pressure and temperature and other vitals. Then you hit a touch screen, you put in what's wrong with you, your symptoms. And then based on all that information, it links you up with a doctor remotely. Live with a doctor, the doctor asks you some questions. The doctor can unlock certain features, certain other monitoring things which may be important depending on what your malady is. Then that doctor could do a diagnosis and can prescribe drugs. So if that health spot is in or near a pharmacy, it could go right to the pharmacy and get your drugs and you could get an immediate form of health care. There's an example of a practical solution, and they offer a financial model where it makes sense for the pharmacy and the doctor and very, very low cost for the patient. It does require an attendant to come in and disinfect after every patient, but it's really kind of a very clever way of taking technology
and the fact that doctor's visits cost a lot and you shouldn't have to physically go there and solving a problem. Now the question is obviously is will our system in terms of how things are paid for catch up with these phenomenal innovative developments? And what I'm hoping for and encourage is a lot of experiments in that area. I think some of the states can do that, countries can do that, and that's the direction we should head. Yes.
David Wilcox, Reach Scale. There's a 2 to 2.5 billion people in the world who don't have any access. And it's highly unlikely they'll get access with the current cost structures as attractive as they are in the global north. So I'm curious if your organization or organizations you work with are working on that problem. If you have a methodology for finding the innovators from the global south that you're going to need to partner with in order to solve the problem. And if you have some ideas about how underutilized resources from a variety of places like multilateral organizations and so on could be brought into play to dramatically lower the cost structure for getting access to the last 2 billion people, which probably means it has to be done without cell towers.
That's a good question. So what I talk about in my upcoming book, Ninja Innovation, is that obviously you have to set the goal. And you've defined a really good goal. Everyone in the world should have internet access. You know, with a healthcare law, I wish they'd sat down and said, our goal is everyone, no one in the United States should ever lack for healthcare, and we have to cover everyone. How do we get there? Then asked everyone, and we would have come up with solutions. Your goal is a very ambitious goal, and I would agree with it. It's obviously going to take time, though, because, you know, internet access requires a number of things. It requires a certain form of electricity, even if it's remote or crank up batteries. It requires a distribution and infrastructure, which isn't as great as even electricity itself, having a wireline distribution structure. You know, I read recently that Facebook may have about 1 billion users soon. China has more internet users than the United States now. The numbers you're talking about, though, the growth rate is truly phenomenal. I think we will get to probably 90% of the world's internet penetration in the next 5 to 10 years. I'd be shocked if we didn't. What is the role of industry in that? When you talk to CEOs, as I often do, of major companies worldwide, there's no question that every one of them is interested in what they can do from a social good point and how they can get there. But it's a business opportunity as well as a social good, and they do that. The opportunity in the developing market is a great one. I've attended a number of United Nations events focusing on the issue you're talking about, is how do we get the world linked into technology? And as good as United Nations is, as good as development programs are, honestly, it's prices going down through intense competition, companies seeing opportunities for infrastructure. Some of the dangerous things that are going on, are this week there's a conference going on I believe it's in the Arab world, I think it's Dubai. It's the International Telecommunications Union is meeting. They're going the opposite direction. There is two proposals they're considering there. One proposal which would allow basically countries to deny their citizens access to any website outside the country. That is basically what they're trying to do is recover the costs, the revenue they used to get from wired telephone service. In other words, a long-distance call in developing countries used to make a lot of money. Now everyone uses Skype or the Internet, not everyone, because you pointed out some good statistics, but the revenue model has changed dramatically for these developing countries. So they want to basically charge their own citizens to have access to Internet sites around the world. That is being considered by the ITU in the next week and a half as they meet. The other one is for countries to put a block around their country totally for technical reasons to block out the Internet. That goes the totally opposite direction. I think the way to get 100% Internet penetration in the world is to allow the Internet as a quasi NGO private body working really well to continue on its path and bring down costs for everyone. And that includes the opportunity for companies to go in and provide development. That's working in other areas such as purifying water, sanitation. Other areas are getting to countries, but you got to have the countries themselves on board. And what we often find in some developed countries is you have rulers with non-transparent systems offering exclusive monopolies to companies with relatives of their own, enriching the ruling body without any transparency as to how these monopolies are given, because often telecommunications is a monopoly. Our strategy in the United States for broadband distribution has been very clear, and that is that you focus on competition between providers. So 15 years ago, I was giving speeches and talking about we need competition in broadband between cable and broadcast and even power line and over the air. Now we've gotten that. We got to go next step is we have to have competition in wireless delivery of internet. Once you get competition, prices come down. And I know maybe I sound like I'm too free market economics, but it worked. It's working in the U.S. and it's working elsewhere. And the statistics you could point out and say, well, Korea's better, some other countries are better. You have to look at the demographics of a country. You have to look at the physical structure of a country. Even in the United States, most of the United States does not have, in terms of physical miles, physical footprint of the United States, does not have wireless internet service. Because there's vast portions of the country that are uninhabited, and it doesn't make sense unless you're getting it by satellite. So the answer is to encourage competition, to remove barriers, and to be creative. And I see my time has totally expired, and I apologize to the producers here. Thank you very much. I'll be available afterwards, and thanks for being part of this event. Okay, hello again. Our next speaker is from Johnson & Johnson. 8 years ago when we formed WLSA, it was Qualcomm and J&J that were our initial financial sponsors, and a lot of people back then didn't understand what a technology company and a healthcare company had to do with each other. We're way beyond that point. Kim Kadlec is the worldwide vice president of Johnson & Johnson's global marketing group. So in that responsibility, she has agency management, marketing communications, media planning, buying, everything that outreaches to the consumer for all of the three operating divisions and 250-plus companies within Johnson & Johnson. So please welcome Kim Kadlec.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's great to be here with you today. It's a big room. There's a lot of echo. I'm going to start today with a true story. This is Andre James. He is a charismatic man from Birmingham, Alabama. Is that feedback that everyone is hearing? Yes. Hey, guys. Give me a moment.
Podium mic.
All right. Better? Now I can't walk around and be animated. This is Andre James. He is a young man from Birmingham, Alabama, who not so long ago was diagnosed with HIV. He didn't take the diagnosis well. He was shocked. He felt alone. He felt isolated. Let's hear some of Andre's story in his own words.
When I had no song, I was silent. A quiet child, living in a place where my voice was far behind the words I carried in my breast, when whispers and searching eyes were my expression, when desperate silence was so often all I knew, when only my face conveyed my feelings. My name is Andre James, and I am HIV positive. I was diagnosed on February the 15th of 2000. It's like
having the bottom drop out of your selfhood. There's a lot of depression, a lot of isolation, a lot of self-imposed isolation. And I really chose to keep it a secret for about a year. And I remember going home for Christmas, I think it was Christmas of that year, and we took some pictures, I think some family pictures. When I look at those old pictures, I can see the pain and the sadness in my face. Even though I'm smiling, my eyes are like crying out, you know. I kind of shambled through that first year. And I started writing, you know, I wrote, that was another thing. I started just writing poems and started taking that seriously. And just giving me something to focus on that was constructive. I was on the phone talking to my mom. I got tired of caring. I just said, you know, there's something I need to tell you. It just kind of tumbled out. And then, you know, and what came is, what happened is my mom, being my mom, was like, okay, well Andre, we're just going to have to do what we can, you know, to deal with this. We're going to have to and that was the greatest gift that she could have given me, just saying, you know, it's okay.
You can tell that Andre is a very passionate man and quite an engaging storyteller. And he is one of four people that J&J tapped to tell their story on our YouTube platform. And really the message of this platform was that a difficult personal journey did not have to be a solitary one. And Andre is doing well. We've spoken to him recently. He's still a peer educator. And what you'd be surprised to hear, that over 100,000 people viewed that video in 48 hours. And over 25% of that was done on a mobile device. So today, Johnson & Johnson is connecting with people all over the world in ways that we never could have imagined. And mobile technology is such a big part of how we're doing that and how we're bringing access to healthcare to people around the world. And a very important part of that is knowing the people that you're connecting with. And at Johnson & Johnson, we know that all expectant mothers are anxious and need support, that kids have tummy aches and need TLC, they go to school and make friends, they worry and have to learn about managing their skin care and sometimes managing diabetes. They fall in love and sometimes have families, and we grow old. And sometimes we have to get used to a relationship with a new hip. My remote is working as well as my microphone. There we go. We also know at Johnson & Johnson that there are people in the world that don't have a supportive family or a structure that gives them the confidence they need. And we have an opportunity to use mobile technology to give them access and to information that gives them the confidence to make great healthcare decisions. And one of the examples that I brought here today is Text for Baby. This is one of the largest public-private partnerships in the nation, and we're very proud to be one of the founding partners. Moms without access to health care can get health care information through text messaging on their cell phones. They sign up, it's free. And they get information about their baby and themselves through their pregnancy, timed by their due date, and all the way through their child's first year of life. Our goal is to reach over 1 million women by the end of 2012. The White House and other public health care agencies are very supportive and advocates of this program. And we are rolling this program out to other countries around the world in partnership with MAMA. And by the way, Mama has just won an Innovation by Design Award from Fast Company magazine, so we congratulate them here today for that. It's terrific. The intimacy that is created through social media and mobile technology really challenges healthcare companies and marketers to think about their communications more in the sense of quality versus quantity. But as a marketer, I was almost as surprised as this baby appears to be that by 2017, the revenue derived from mobile apps will top $35 billion. That's amazing. So doctors, patients, mothers, fathers, the communities that we work and live in are telling us with their wallet that mobile is the future. Let's look at an example from Band-Aid. Band-Aid brand was launched over 90 years ago. And just recently used augmented technology on mobile devices to create a little magic for kids with boo-boos. Let's take a look.
And my mom was like, put two Band-Aids on it because I think that will help. And I was like, two Band-Aids, awesome.
When I have a tummy, I put a Band-Aid on my belly button.
Can I have another one?
Because it's magical.
First, put on your Band-Aid brand Muppets bandage. Then scan your bandage with your iPhone or iPad.
Look, hi-ho, Kermit the Frog here, feeling blue, not for long.
Then you're ready to start the show.
Why are
you can even swing Kermit.
Songs about rainbows.
My favorite Muppet is Miss Piggy because she's so girly.
Miss Piggy wants you to take a picture.
No, I'm not feeling well. Well, I'll take care of that. It's time to take a picture.
Gonzo does a wacky stunt.
He came out of the rocket and then he got stuck on the glass.
I'm shaking Gonzo.
So a whole new generation gets stuck on Band-Aid. We're proud to say that campaign won a Gold Lion in Cannes this year. We're very proud of that work. A lot of good people. Got a good teamwork made that happen. So Johnson & Johnson is also finding ways to use mobile technology to create tools that change behavior. And one of our most recent examples is the digital health scorecard. We launched this in conjunction with Microsoft, and this is like a credit score for your health. It helps you determine your risk factors for chronic diseases like diabetes or heart and respiratory disease, and it asks you questions about your habits, including how active you are, and do you use tobacco or drink? Now, no cheating. It then gives you a score and your risk factor. And really what this platform does is it empowers people to manage their choices and make smarter choices. And it gives them a convenient way to track their progress. The next example is Care for Today, a mobile health manager that's brought to us by our company, Janssen. It is an app and a website. It is free. And it is a two-way messaging system that is secure. And what it does is help people and remind people to take their medicine, to visit their doctor, to renew their prescription. So another great use of mobile technology that empowers people to manage their healthy destiny. So we've talked today about several ways that Johnson & Johnson is using mobile technology in the world today, but I think we all know in this room that this is only the tip of the iceberg. And at Johnson & Johnson, we are committed to creating more value through innovation in mobile technology. And we can't do it alone. And I just want to take a second to thank all of our partners that are on this journey with us. A lot of you are here today, and we thank you. We know that together, we can make connections that change lives. And if we keep purpose at our core, and we have mobile technology as the wind at our back, we can create a world that is better, healthier, and happier for families all over the world. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Kim. I couldn't see you out here. Back there, we were all jumping around during the Sesame Street jingle, so I hope you are as well. We have our last speaker. Just emphasize, I think the videos that Kim showed were so powerful, especially the first one, because it reminds us that this is about people. It's not about technology. And our messaging is that it is about health, not just about health care. And it's interesting, and I feel I'm an optimist at heart, I suppose, but our next speaker, Raj Panu, from McCann Health, is here, and his charge, and McCann has taken on the notion, this is the biggest health communications company in the world, and they have a focus on driving the global public health community to adopt these technologies. And I noticed on their website that they recently changed their name for this group from McCann Healthcare to McCann Health. So that gives me hope that these messages are being received by the commercial world, which has to drive many of these changes. So Dr. Raj Panu is Director of Global Public Health at McCann Health, and please welcome him.
Yes? Okay. It's great to be here. It's fantastic to be here. Thank you so much for this opportunity to speak at this wonderful conference that really exists at the nexus of research, of technology, and of course of health policy. And you know, I have to apologize in advance because I'm not going to be talking about any of those things here. And so that's the first apology that I have. The second is that originally scheduled today was our CEO, but unfortunately he was called away, so unfortunately you guys are going to have to deal with me, so that's the second apology. So I've disappointed you twice, and I haven't even started the speech yet. So hopefully it'll speak for itself. So what I'm going to be talking about is demand creation. And I think this is, you know, this has been such an interesting experience over the last couple of days because, you know, it's almost the kind of invisible gorilla in the room, if you will. I'm not sure that's an actual phrase, but you guys feel free to tweet it and use it. In a sense, because, you know, there's a lot of talk about new technology, and this is, of course, absolutely essential to how mHealth is going to progress. But, you know, part and parcel of introducing new technologies, new initiatives, is making sure that there is sufficient demand within your target population for those products and services. Because if there isn't, then it doesn't matter. Then it's just background noise. So, you know, I'm speaking on behalf of McCann, but I'm actually speaking on behalf of marketing and communication companies, you know, large ones around the world, because there is a methodology, there is a way to approach strategic communications That has been shown, you know, since time immemorial, to be successful in driving behavior change and adoption of new practices. And I'm going to share some of those with you today. So let's talk about very quickly who we are. So McCann, obviously, it's part of McCann World Group. McCann World Group, one of the largest advertising, marketing, and communications companies in the world. And, you know, unfortunately, also the largest spreader of measles throughout the world, as you can see by this map. Truly, you know, global footprint. And, you know, we have a lot of long-standing relationships with very large companies and many over, you know, decades and decades, helping these companies sell commodities and services around the world. And McCann Health basically uses these same techniques that have been utilized to sell commodities in the health space to, you know, basically drive demand for pharmaceutical products, among other things. So what does this have to do with global public health? Well, in terms of what we've found is that global public health is very often about driving behavior change. I think we all recognize that. And one thing that we know for sure is that if you're just creating awareness of a problem, that is not sufficient to drive behavior change. Creating awareness is not creating demand. So in order to essentially implement effective behavior change efforts, it's very, very important that sort of rigorous data-driven demand creation methodology is used. I mean, there's no doubt that that's true. And what this means is an increased emphasis on the customer. That is, the person that you're trying to target. What do they think? What are the barriers to use of whatever device or service that you're trying to implement? And understanding essentially the relevant forces that shape customers' habits and perspectives is what's going to get people to use technologies. The last part of demand creation, of course, is using some kind of methodology. Very often in public health, there are attempts to recreate, you know, these ideas using, studies and research and trying to essentially reinvent the wheel, when in fact there are methodologies that communications companies, for example, use all the time to do all of these things. And I think that this is what the private sector certainly has to offer in terms of global public health. So, if you think about it, you know, a lot of the big problems in health have essentially been driven by market-based uptake of health, you know, products that are essentially bad for people. You know, take tobacco or whether it's, you know, bad food products. And the methodologies that were used to drive those, the uptake, the change in behavior, and the uptake of those kinds of products, what we're saying is we need to simply use those same strategies to counter detail those ideas. And I think it's important. So there are basically three pillars to any kind of demand creation platform. The first, of course, is assessment and insight. The second is developing your messages and figuring out how to engage your target audience. And the third is being able to measure and evaluate what you've done to make sure that it's impactful and to make sure that it's working. And underneath these sort of pillars, of course, there are ways, methods to go about conducting this kind of work. And obviously, market research is absolutely essential. And trying to basically figure out what the dynamics of the market are and trying to include all the necessary and pertinent relevant information that's going to drive uptake of whatever product or service that you have. The second in messaging and engagement, well, once you know who your customers are and what they think, then you can develop a strategy. It's the strategy and the concept, the execution, and that is part of the essentially the communications plan. And once this has been accomplished, then, and implemented, then you can go back and use analytics to understand how successful that you've been. It's actually incredibly intuitive. And yet, very often in the public health space, this is something that has been overlooked. And I think probably to the detriment of many kinds of programs. So at McCann, we use this thing. It's called the truth to transformation process. It doesn't really matter. But the key point is that you've got to find out what the problem is. That's the most important thing. We call that the naked truth. We have to know what fundamentally is the barrier that you're trying to overcome in your customer's mind, in their behaviors, in their habits, that allows you, you know, to then counter-detail it, to come up with that perfect argument that, you know, may be most impactful. And obviously, the truth, knowing what that barrier is, and it could be different for different communities, and that's something you would have to know as well, so you can target your communications. That is based on a number of this ecosystem of factors, you know, the category, the company, we call it the five C's. But the point is you must ask critical questions in order to get to the truth. And it's only when a rigorous analysis of people's behavior is done that you're going to be able to find the best ways to influence them. And then, of course, you know, in advertising, we develop creative briefs, and we try to essentially, what we call the transformational truth, is then that ability to successfully argue to implement whatever it is that your uptake of your product or service. This is absolutely essential, because when you get to the next step, which is messaging and engagement, at this point, this is how you develop your strategy. And I think the point about, you know, mHealth apps or, you know, any of these other technologies is that the technology cannot be leading the discussion. What needs to be leading the strategic framework is, who are you trying to talk to? And what do you want them to do? And this has to be absolutely rigorously defined in order to drive uptake. So obviously you have to be nimble. You have to be able to, you know, use key performance indicators to be able to analyze uptake. And we know that, you know, there's so much big data discussion over this conference, and we know that this is going to be certainly a key part of mHealth applications. So when we look at demand creation in mHealth, I think probably the key unmet need is trying to make sure that we're not letting the technology lead. I think that's probably the key takeaway, because, I mean, of course there are amazing breakthrough technologies that can do extraordinary things, certainly in mHealth and other places. I mean, God, think about the airplane. You know, I don't think you have to sell the airplane. I think the airplane pretty much sells itself. But generally speaking, when it comes to the vast world of mHealth technologies, there'll probably be many, many, many different technologies all sort of competing for share of voice with the same customers. And that is something that we have to sort of consider, and that is why sort of strategic approaches to drive uptake, to drive demand for these products, to see how these products can be used, optimized, ergonomically, to allow the consumer to have the best possible experience so that it makes sense to their lives. That's why it's important. Because essentially, that's what we're talking about. We're talking about this ecosystem where the consumer, the individual, is at the center, and around that consumer, there is this sort of giant noise of public and private sector interests. And what we're trying to do is get this consumer to make generally healthy choices that will improve their lives. And by doing this with individuals, you know, it can have tremendous impact on, you know, societies. And so our proposition, to reiterate, is simply make sure that strategic approaches to communication are implemented before these technologies are created or in the process of creating these technologies. Because obviously there's an enormous demand. I mean, you just look, I mean, you know, there's so many slides that we've seen where we see the extent of chronic disease or even, transmission of, infectious disease. And we know that these incidences are rising, and certainly globally, public health needs to, there's an enormous need for successful personally directed interventions. And of course, it's not just that, but there's a significant economic impact of these diseases and conditions. Absolutely, no question about it. Which means that, successful implementation is of paramount importance. So ultimately, I guess what we're saying is that, I think, certainly if you look at developing countries, when you, so many technologies, so much infrastructure has been created in the hopes that people will just come and use, the products or services. And you know what happens? They spend a lot of time and a lot of money and they build up these things and nobody uses them. And so strategic approaches to demand creation, certainly must be a factor and certainly in mHealth as well. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for attending this afternoon's luncheon. At this time, we would ask that you please vacate the room as quickly as possible, as we need to clear the room and turn over for tonight's entertainment. Thank you, and enjoy the rest of the conference.